Simon & Schuster Audio presents Feast Your Eyes by Myla Goldberg. Read by the author. With Samantha Desz, Lisa Flanagan, Joy Osmanski, Jacques Roy, and Candace Thaxton.
I was 10 when I saw it. Pops sitting across the breakfast table with his daily news and his cigarette. I looked up from my cornflakes, and there it was, staring at me from the front page. A little kid in her underwear, with black bars printed over her eyes and her chest. She was holding out a glass of milk to some woman lying on a bed, and there was a dark spot on the sheet between the woman's legs. The headline above the photo was the same monster size they used when JFK got shot the year before. Judge rules, mommy is sick. Man, I thought that girl must have made her mom sick with a glass of milk and made her bleed. She had to be real trouble, that girl, because how else do you get your photo on the front page of the newspaper? On the TV news that night, she was crossed out just the same. This time sitting on a couch in a beaded necklace. Walter Cronkite said her name was Samantha and her mother was a photographer, Lillian Preston. The pictures in the paper and on TV were from 8 photographs that he called the Samantha series. They had been on display in a photography show until the gallery got shut down because Samantha was mostly naked in the pictures, not to mention that the photo from the morning paper, which was actually called Mommy is Sick, had to do with abortion. I didn't know what abortion was, except that it was against the law and some kind of sin, but that was enough. I grabbed the daily news from the trash bin and stashed it under my bed, and that was how Samantha Preston became a dark goddess to me. Whenever the world went gray, I would pull out Mommy is Sick and stare at a girl who was 10 times worse trouble than I ever was, until I'd start to feel better. I was 20 before I saw the photo again. I'd been in the city a few years, working lousy jobs and going to shows, and my friend Brian and I decided to start a band. As I was looking through one of his crazy scrapbooks, there it was. Same picture, same headline. The song came to me right away, like I'd been writing it in my head all that time. When we put out Mommy is Sick as a single, we used a repro of the newspaper clipping for the record sleeve because there was no one to tell us not to. Then we got signed, and they told us we had to ask permission for that kind of thing. But it had been 10 years, and no one we asked even knew who Lillian Preston was. So for the album cover, we made our own version. Brian in bed with ketchup between his legs, and me in my underwear holding out the milk glass, black grease paint over my eyes and black electrical tape over my B cups. By the time we were asked to play Saturday Night Live, I was performing in that getup only for special occasions, but national live TV is as special as it comes, which is why America saw just half of Mommy is Sick before I ripped off my dress and the network cut to a commercial. A few days later, the phone rang. I picked up and a voice asked, "Are you Frances Pell?" "Who is this?" I said. "This is Samantha," said the voice on the phone. "Samantha who?" There was a pause, then a click, and then it was too late. After that, Brian and I were touring a lot, doing all the stupid things people do, living that kind of a life. Whenever we came back to New York, our manager would drop off a box of band mail that had been sent to the label. To sort through it, Brian and I would spend hours holed up in his apartment drinking Jack and Coke. People sent all kinds of stuff. Poetry, drawings, love letters, hate letters. One night, I opened a big yellow envelope with my name on it, and inside was a picture of me sitting cross-legged on the hood of a car. I had no memory of anyone taking that photo or of sitting on that car to begin with, which wasn't unusual in those days, but it felt like I'd been spied on. Brian was pissed when I tore the photo in half. He said it was a great shot, but what mattered to me was the invasion of privacy. After Brian grabbed the envelope, he read the note that came with it, then started shaking his head. "Nice job, shithead. You just tore up a photograph by Lillian Preston." When he showed me her name, I wanted to kick my own ass. For the next 20-odd years of making music, my Lillian Preston story stayed filed away with everything else I wished I'd done differently. Until I got a call from a curator at the Museum of Modern Art. They were planning a Lillian Preston show. Would I take a look at the photographs? Maybe write something for the catalog? I figured this would be my chance to thank her. The math in my head told me Lillian Preston was in her 50s, so when I got there, I was looking for a middle-aged person. Waiting for me in the curator's office instead was a woman about my age. I was pretty sure I'd seen her somewhere, but that's a feeling I get all the time. Then she said, "Are you Frances Pell?" "Don't hang up," yelled the voice inside my head. "I know who you are." For the rest of that day, we looked at her mother's photographs. I thought they'd all be naked people, but they weren't, at least not in the usual way. Lillian Preston was mostly a street photographer. She lived her life, blending into backgrounds and snapping whoever passed by. For all that, these people aren't strangers. Sometimes it's a look in the eyes or the way someone is standing, but what's unfamiliar lifts away. The people in Lillian Preston's pictures seem like people I know. Sometimes, looking at a stranger, it feels like I'm looking at myself. I'll be honest, I didn't always like what I saw. It's hard being jolted like that, time after time, truth after truth, in black and white. But it's also beautiful. These photos, whatever else they may be, are also beautiful. Some of them are from before anyone heard of Lillian Preston or the Samantha series, but most are from the years that came after Lillian and her daughter had been threatened, followed, and forced to change their address and phone number. After Lillian had been called brilliant, poetic, brave, visionary, exploitative, criminal, neglectful, selfish, and a bad mother. By 1973, when the Supreme Court finally got around to changing the definition of what was obscene, not to mention rewriting abortion law, Lillian Preston had pretty much stopped showing her pictures to anyone. Luckily, that wasn't the same thing as not making pictures at all. If you're reading this, you already know all that. You've seen the photographs at the show, or you've looked through the images in the front half of this catalog, and you've seen all that hard beauty for yourself. So let me tell you something you don't know. Aside from the 7,000 rolls of film and hundreds of prints Lillian left behind when she died, separate from the binders of technical notes, were three boxes. Box one held Lillian's 24 journals from the summer she split Cleveland at age 17 to the day cancer killed her at 40. Box two contained the prints she'd made for this exhibition, plus a letter asking her daughter to bring them to MoMA in case they might do for her dead what they'd never done for her alive. Box three had the prints and negatives from the Samantha series and a letter giving her daughter a choice: destroy them or include them with the prints in box two. Believe it or not, the woman Samantha Jane Preston turned into was going to let some curatorial shirt write about the photographs in this exhibition. "Are you crazy?" I told her. "The only one who can do that is you. You're the one who lived with Lillian, who fought with her, who knew her friends, who went through the whole Samantha thing and came out the other end. Use everything. Use her diaries. Use her letters. Go back and talk to the important people in her life. To show her work in a way that an art establishment type never could." I got a long stare after that. Or what I thought was a long stare, until I realized that she'd gone somewhere deep inside herself, and I just happened to be standing in front of her. Then in a quiet voice that was more for herself than anyone else, she said, "It's too late for a lot of things, but I guess it's not too late for that." And so this catalog was written by someone whose life was tangled up in these photographs, along with the lives of all the people who helped make them. Whether they were standing in front of the camera, behind the camera, or somewhere off to the side. Because of that, it's not like any catalog you've read before. It's personal. It's unprofessional. And when the art establishment type saw it, they were smart enough to leave it alone. Frances Pell, a.k.a. Franny Panic. New York, 1990.
Catalog of the exhibition. All works are by Lillian Preston, unless otherwise noted, and are from the artist's estate. Greenwich Village, 1953 through 54. 1. Untitled. Prentice High Camera Club, Cleveland, 1951. Unknown photographer. Feast your eyes, America. Here she is, America's worst mother, America's bravest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.